I'm Dr. Karen McCormick, and tonight we're going to talk about natural approach to menopause. So, I lost my track. So, back where we were, that very little has changed, except for now they're moving away from using artificial hormone replacement to more natural approaches. A lot of what I'm going to go through in this packet is very basic things that, I mean, my whole goal is that when you guys leave here tonight, that you're going to have two or three things that you can start doing tomorrow. I mean, I've been to lots of workshops, and do you ever go to a workshop and ton of information? I mean, really great information. And then you leave and you're all excited, and then a week later you're going, there was nothing practical that I could put right into action. So the whole goal of this is I want you tomorrow morning be able to already have two or three steps that you can go, you know what, I'm going to start doing that. And maybe a week from now you can pull the information out again and go, you know what, I'm going to start this now. And slowly start to move towards a more holistic approach. Okay, so that being said, one of the things I want to talk about in terms of health is that it's not like black and white. It's not like I'm healthy or I'm unhealthy. That's not really how the way our bodies are. It's not like I'm in good health here and I'm in bad health here. Health is like a continuum, okay? So you have like perfect health over here and you have one step from the grave over here. And it's a continuum, okay? So, you know, we all fall somewhere along that health line. And my theory is that the more things that we're doing right, the closer we are over here. More things we're doing wrong, the closer we are over here. And if you can make a few different choices, you can move yourself on that continuum over here. Okay? So it's someone walking in and we'll get started right now. There you go. Okay. Hi.
Hi. There
you go. Do you have a pen?
No.
No? I'll get one for you.
Can we get these pens?
Oh, yeah. It's all for you.
Thank you.
Okay. So the first page right here just talks a little bit about the endocrine system, and that the endocrine system pretty much regulates And you know what? I'm going to probably lecture for about, maybe about a half hour, and then I want to leave a lot of time for questions because I'm sure everybody's going to have a lot of questions that may pertain particularly to them. Okay. So the first page talks about the endocrine system pretty much regulates the body's continuous ongoing processes of a lot of things. Reproduction, growth, development, cellular metabolism, energy, blood balance of nutrients, electrolytes, water, mobilization of body defenses against stressors, pretty much everything. So if you can think of something, the endocrine system in your body regulates it. So hormone production, obviously, digestion, excretion, growth. I mean, everything is under the control of the endocrine system. So the challenge with it is that hormones are very easily, and the endocrine system is very easily tipped off base. And those things don't always show up. It's not like you get an infection and you get a cold, or it's not like you get the hammer and you hit your finger and you feel that reaction immediately. When you have imbalances in your body, it's an insidious process that doesn't always show up immediately. So a lot of the things that we're going to talk about are things that can be attributed to a lot of things, but because the body is controlled pretty much primarily by the endocrine system, we can trace it back to that. Okay? So if you turn to the next page, and I promise I won't get too technical. For those of you that like technical, this is a diagram of all of the endocrine producing systems in the body. Okay, it's all the glands. So we have the pineal gland, we have the pituitary gland, we have the thyroid gland, we have the adrenal gland, the pancreas, the ovaries, and the testes. And then on the side it says exactly what it controls. So tonight, since we're talking about menopause, we're going to spend a lot of time talking about the adrenal gland, and we're going to talk a little bit about the liver, and we're going to talk about the ovaries. Okay? So you can keep that and look at that later. So one of the first things that I want to talk about in terms of hormone balance is liver. Okay? And it's, you would think, now what does the liver have to do with imbalances in my endocrine system? Does anybody have a thought about that? Does anyone know what the liver does?
It detoxifies,
yep. One of the things about the liver, and it's really one of those overlooked organs, other than, you know, you think, well, if I don't drink a lot, I'm not gonna have a problem with my liver. One of the things about the liver is that it detoxifies and it keeps our blood pure and it keeps our body pure. And lots of times we find that when we are living in unhealthy, meaning that we maybe not eating properly or we're exposed to a lot of toxins or different things, our liver gets bogged down and it can't do what it's supposed to do. So the endocrine glands secrete hormones that are secreted by the liver or are chemically altered by the liver to make them water soluble so that the body can get rid of them effectively. So if you're exposed to a lot of toxins or you're drinking or you're taking a lot of medications, if your liver is not functioning properly or your endocrine system is not functioning properly, your body can't make it into a form that can be gotten rid of, okay? So if your liver is busy working on processing things like sugar and dairy and fats, it's unable to process the estrogen. And the steroid hormones that are processed by the liver include estrogen, cortisol, aldosterone, thyroxine, and others. And the liver is responsible for the metabolism and storage of carbohydrates as well as assimilation of fat and water-soluble vitamins. Okay, so let's break this down to make this something that's practical. So lots of times when people are having problems with weight loss or they're having problems with menopause or they're having problems with diabetes or other things like that, one of the places that is overlooked that's actually very important is a healthy functioning liver. Okay. Has anybody heard that before, or is that, no? Okay, maybe you have heard that before, okay. So one of the ways to get your liver functioning better, and I'm gonna talk about this, this doesn't mean you have to go out and do this tomorrow, but is eliminating sugar, coffee, alcohol, white flour, processed foods, and unnecessary medications from your diet. They're all things that bog your liver down. Now, I'm not saying, I mean, I don't eat that way, however, when I can make a choice, I try to lean more towards the organic way, or I try to, you know, evaluate, you know, do I want to eat that if it's highly processed. Drinking 8 to 10 glasses of pure water daily. One of the things about water is that we actually, even though we may not feel thirsty, we're actually dehydrated. Okay, I actually have a good friend that I went to college with, I roomed with my senior year. And we laugh, she's a family doctor. And we were having this really great conversation about health and holistic. And I said, you know, what would be the one thing that you would tell your patients to do if you could pick one thing, all your patients? She said, drink more water. I said, that's probably one of the few things we actually agree upon. And the thing is, water is necessary for pretty much every process in your body, okay? Especially hormone production. And when we become dehydrated, our body will take water from any necessary place that it can to keep those things functioning. And usually it will come from your muscles. That's why if you're real tight and sore, or if you've ever had a massage and the massage therapist says, make sure you drink a lot of extra water. Because your body will take that water from unnecessary places so that it can keep functioning. The exact amount of water that you should drink is actually your body weight divided by 2. So if you weigh, say you weigh 200 pounds, you should drink 100 ounces a day, okay? So if you divide that by 8 ounces, I guess that would be 9, 10, you know, maybe 12 glasses of water. And it sounds like a lot, and it's funny because people will say, well, I can't drink that much because I'll be running to the bathroom continuously. And what's interesting is that if you slowly increase your water intake, over time your body will accommodate and regulate. Have you done that before? Yeah. So the first couple days you're going to be peeing like every half hour till eventually your body will start to regulate itself and you won't urinate as much. Your urine should be a straw color. It should be like a light straw color. If it's real dark yellow, you're dehydrated, okay? That water's being pulled to function in other areas. So one of the biggest things that you can do just to keep your liver functioning good is drink more water. Your body will function better, your muscles will feel better, pretty much everything. Your fat metabolism will be better, okay? The next one is B vitamins. Does anybody take any vitamins right now? Multis, or what's everybody? Multi? Is there B?
B complex.
B complex is actually a really, besides vitamin D, that's another one. I'll talk a little bit about D after this, but B is really an important vitamin for hormone production and also for healthy functioning liver. B complex. Well, B complex means there's lots of different Bs in it. Yeah.
I notice when I take my B complex, my urine is bright yellow.
Yeah.
So I can't tell whether I have had enough water or not because.
Yeah, it becomes like very artificial. That is because what your body's not using, it flushes out. It's really, you don't want to take a ton more than you should, but with B and C, for the most part, your body will get rid of what you don't utilize. So, yeah. And you may find if you stay consistently on the B, it won't be as yellow. So I don't know if you've noticed that. Okay, avoid toxins when possible. So I want to talk a little bit about this because this is always a question people ask me. With organic, so you only have so much money. You know, you can't, in a perfect world, it'd be great to eat organic everything. My two schools of thought are with vegetables, if you can peel it, okay, or you can wash it really good. They have different washes that you can soak the vegetables in. If you can wash it really good or you can peel it, I would say save the money and not do organic vegetables, with the exception of blueberries, strawberries, raspberries, anything that's really hard to clean. If you're going to put your money into something, I would say meat and dairy. If you drink dairy, that would probably be the two biggest areas. Organic grains, not as important. So meat and dairy. Exercise for 30 minutes daily. Really important. I mean, it's important for cardio, but also really important to keep that liver functioning. I know it sounds crazy because you're thinking, what does the liver have to do with exercise? Really important for the liver to keep it functioning. And then eat an apple a day. Apple is really, truthfully, yeah, apple is fantastic. It helps with digestion, and it helps the liver process fats.
You missed.
What did I miss?
Avoid artificial sweetener.
Boy, this is one of my big. All right, no judgment, but show of hands. Who uses, like, aspartame or Sweet and Low or no one? Guys are awesome.
Splenda.
Stevia is okay. Stevia is natural. Good.
What about like alcohol, sugar alcohols, like erythritol and xylitol?
Oh, they're okay. Yeah, okay. Yeah, they're natural. They're more. They're better processed. I think that has a funny taste though. The xylitol. Do you think it has a little bit of
No, but I think erythritol has a funny taste.
A little funny taste. I like the agave. I like that. I don't really like the stevia either. I'd rather, but nobody drinks Diet Coke or Diet Pepsi.
I love it, but I don't drink it anymore.
Really bad. In fact, there's studies, they've certain people, and I don't know what the criteria is, but some people have really bad reactions. They don't realize it. If they drink so much, they get almost like MS-like symptoms. So, okay. So the next thing that I want to talk about, let's get into the estrogen-progesterone imbalances. One of the most important things, everybody when they think of estrogen and progesterone, they think that menopause is this disease that suddenly my ovaries aren't functioning, I'm not getting enough estrogen, and now that's why I'm getting all these symptoms. Is that pretty much what everybody thinks? Isn't that kind of what you've thought? Okay, I'm getting around that age and now I'm getting a lot of symptoms, and it's because my estrogen level has dropped. So what's interesting is that the way that they're looking at it now, so real quick, I'm gonna back up. Do you know that in China, has anybody ever read the book, The China Study? Anybody ever heard of it? Okay. It's a book that did like a 10-year study on women in China, middle-aged women in China. And do you know that there's not even a word for menopause in the Chinese language? Did you know that?
I've heard that, yeah.
Well, you know, it's funny because I had heard that years ago. And I actually have an exchange student this year from China. So I said to him, his name's Barry. That's hard to believe that. But his name's Barry, Barry Wang. So I said to him, hey, do you know what menopause is? My kids are all like, oh. And he's like, no. He's like, I've never heard of that word. No, no, I don't really know. So I explained to him. He's like, no. So truly, they don't have that word. And the studies have shown, if you read this book, it's amazing. It's called The China Study. And that, it's not specifically about menopause. It's about other health issues. But they studied women in China, and they found that they don't have any of the symptoms of menopause. They also have lower heart disease and heart issues. But they have almost no symptoms of menopause. They don't even have the words for it. And what they came up with was because their diet, the Chinese diet, is almost majority of Chinese diet is plant-based. So it has a lot of soy in it. It has a lot of plant-based, and it's lower animal-based. So it's fascinating. Anyway, also Chinese, they run, it's a different, the culture is very different. So we set ourselves up for a lot of different symptoms that we have. But the newer thoughts with menopause is that it's not so much that the estrogen has bottomed out, okay? It's that there's an imbalance between the estrogen and the progesterone. And that comes not so much from, I mean, it's normal, as our bodies were designed, that as we go out of childbearing years, that our estrogen is going to drop. But it's the drop in correlation with the progesterone that is really where the symptoms come from. And sometimes if you do have a gynecologist that maybe they have recommended estrogen, they'll give you one with estrogen and progesterone because they know it's the flow. And I'm not gonna go through the whole cycle, but you know, the menstrual cycle, it's, you know, the estrogen increases as the progesterone goes down, and then they meet and they peak and then they drop down together. And it's this flow. And what happens is because of lifestyle choices, it gets completely out of whack, okay? So one of the things that I wanna talk about, which is really common, and I'm not saying everybody here has it, but I do have a checklist and you can kind of go through symptoms, is that a lot of women suffer not so much from, you know, menopause symptoms as they do adrenal fatigue symptoms. Okay, has anybody heard of adrenal fatigue? No, okay. So, think of a good example. So the adrenal glands are these teeny tiny little glands that sit right on top of the kidney. Let me see if I have a picture. Do I have a picture? No, I don't, okay. Yeah, I do. Okay, there they are. So they're these little teeny tiny glands. So they really have been overlooked for many years. And it's actually all the research, if you go home and you plug in adrenals, most of the research has come out over the last 15 years about adrenal insufficiency and adrenal fatigue and blah, 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 blah. So what happens with adrenal glands are when, think of an example. So in the old days, if we were in like caveman times, and I was out hunting, and I saw the big saber-toothed tiger, and he was lunging at me, my adrenal glands, we have something in our body called fight or flight, right? My fight system, my sympathetic system, would go into action. I would either kill the animal, or I would run away, or whatever. And it dumps hormones into my system to cause me to react. Okay? So as I'm reacting and I'm running or I'm fighting the tiger and I'm killing it, my system is actually resetting. So I have this surge. It's like putting the gas on, okay? And I'm fighting the animal, I'm doing everything, I'm physically active, and then my system slows down. The parasympathetic system slows down. We have two systems in our body. We have the sympathetic system and the parasympathetic system. One revs you up, one calms you down. So in the old days, if this happened, I would fight the tiger, or I'd run away, or I'd do whatever, and then my body would reset itself. In the last part of this century, especially the last maybe 20, 30 years, as technology has crept up and life has become very fast-paced, and we get revved up, and there's no release. There's no, our sympathetic system goes up, and then there's nothing to bring it back down. So, you know, you're driving in the car and someone cuts you off and you get, and your sympathetic system goes up, but you're not jumping out of the car beating the heck out of the person who cut you off, or your boss yells at you. You're not, obviously not gonna yell back, you know, so we're revving our system up continually. We're drinking coffee, we're eating sugar, we're going, we're on the phone, doing three things, we're running around, you know. We ramp our bodies up, and what happens is we're not getting that reset. So they find it, and men get adrenal fatigue as well. It's not just women, but for some reason it's been more studied in women, and I think women actually, most of the stuff I've read about has been about women, but I can't imagine that men don't get it as well. When we're under chronic stress for long periods of time, I mean, our body doesn't know the difference. So if you yell at me and you say you hate me and this is the worst lecture you've been at, right? Mm-hmm. And I get all upset and my, there's no difference between that and the saber-toothed tiger chasing me. Do you get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like my brain isn't, it doesn't register any different. It's still stress. You know, my kids are giving me a hard time, it's still stress. It doesn't matter what the stress is, stress is stress is stress. The difference is when it's good stress, you know, like someone, you know, having a baby or getting married or moving and it's a good move. There's that reset because your body is now, I don't know how to explain it, but your body is going into that parasympathetic mode. But when it's chronic bad stress, there's nothing ever bringing it back down. So studies have shown when you're these glands are continually bombarded, what happens is they eventually shut down. They eventually just go, I'm done, that's it. And then what happens is a lot of symptoms happen. One being horrible hormone imbalances. In fact, if you want to turn to, adrenal fatigue checklist. Okay, so some of these things are difficulty getting up in the morning, continuing fatigue, not relieved by rest.
Letters that?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's this.
Pretty far back.
Okay. I'll
keep turning.
Lethargy, sugar cravings, salt cravings. Who craves sugar and salt when they're stressed? I mean, it's funny, our bodies, it's all biochemical, you know? Digestion problems, increased effort to get tasks done, inability to handle stress. I mean, you can go through these increased PMS symptoms. Intolerance for stress, noise, disorder. Don't really wake up till 10 a.m., afternoon low, that 3 to 4 low. Feel a little better after eating dinner. Get a second wind if you stay up too late. And feel like I have to keep moving. If I stop, I get tired. So you can kind of look at that. So that's the adrenal fatigue checklist. So one of the things I say about hormone imbalance, and in our office when I have patients that are, you know, come to me and say, well, what can I take for now? You know, what can I take so that I'm not having these? Here's my symptoms. One of the first things I do, besides getting them to drink water, is I say, let's slow down and let's talk about your adrenal glands and let's put some things in place to help treat your adrenal glands. Now, sometimes patients actually wanna, you know, they'll say, well, I don't know if I have adrenal fatigue syndrome. And I'll say, okay, well, there's blood work that you can do, and it's called cortisol levels. Has anybody ever heard of that, or has anybody had that done? Your cortisol levels done? Okay. So one of the things about cortisol is that cortisol should be really high in the morning. Cortisol is the hormone that's secreted by the adrenal glands, okay, when you're under stress. So cortisol should be higher in the morning, and I think I put a chart in there. I don't mean to get too techy, but you will see. Nope, I took it out. When I redid these packets, I took it out. My husband's like, this is so boring. No one really cares about me. Anyway, I shouldn't listen to that. The cortisol should be real high in the morning, and then as the day goes on, it should slowly start to wind down, where it bottoms out late in the afternoon, early evening. Okay, so cortisol should be high in the morning and low at night. And sometimes with patients, I'll send them and I'll have them get a morning and PM, an AM and PM cortisol. So they'll get a blood draw in the morning and then they'll get a blood draw at night. And lots of times people that have adrenal fatigue, you'll see that it's flipped. Their cortisol level is low when it should be high and high when it should be low. So one of the first things that I do when people come to me with all sorts of symptoms of menopause or premenopause, I'll say, let's get your adrenal glands working again. And they'll say, well, how do you know they're not working? I'm like, and I'll list off some things, and I'm okay. Just work with me with this, and let's see. So one of the first things with adrenal glands, besides drinking water, is sleep. This is the number one, I'm telling you, thing, is if you can get your sleep patterns under control, it's like half the battle, okay? And I'll tell you a little bit why. First of all, when you sleep, okay, that's your body's time to heal, okay? It's the time for everything to kind of reset. You know, if you've ever been sick and you feel really crappy and you just want to go to bed and sleep for, you know, 2 days, that's because that's your body saying, shut down, okay? I need to heal, I need to repair. And they've actually done studies on people that do shift work that have like really wacky altered schedules. And those people have lower, I brought that study, it's pretty cool. They have actually lower, trying to think of what, not white blood cells, they have lower something in their blood that shows that they're more prone to infection. They tend to get sick easier when you do shift work. And then also they tend to have more fluctuation with their hormones as well, because they're not on a typical cycle. So, back to sleep. You should go to bed the same time every night, or approximately the same time. You need to force yourself to do this, because I guarantee if we talk about it, everyone, don't you? You're tired around 8 o'clock, and you're like, I just can't go to bed yet. I think I'm gonna watch this show or fold this laundry or finish up what I gotta do. And then you push through it and you hit 10 or 11 o'clock and then you have a hard time falling asleep. So when your body is tired, you need to go to bed. And it may take you a couple weeks to get your rhythm. You'll figure out exactly when that is. But for most of us, it's gonna be around 9, 10 o'clock at night. It's gonna be when you need to go to bed. Okay, you need to get your butt in bed, okay? Now, the other thing is you need to get up approximately the same time every day. So, and that's the problem with shift work, is that people that do shift work, they'll sleep in, they'll get up, they'll sleep in. It's a crazy schedule. You need to get up the same time. So if you get up every day for work at, I don't know, 5:30, 6 o'clock, even on your days off, you really should be approximately on that same schedule. Your body doesn't know the difference. Your body doesn't know that it's Saturday. It just knows that it's on a rhythm. I mean, anyone, you guys, I don't know who has children and who doesn't, but what's good for kids? What's good for babies? It's the schedule, it's the rhythm, it's the predictability. Your body needs to predict what's gonna happen so that it can shut down. So sleep is the biggest thing. I'm not huge into drugs. I mean, obviously I'm a chiropractor. I believe it does, you know, drugs have their time and place when necessary, but you know, I am all for, if you need assistance in getting regulated, you know, talk to your family doc about some sleep aids, or you know, try the melatonin, or there's different things that you can do. But the number one thing to get some of the symptoms with menopause and perimenopause is sleep. End of story. Anybody have any questions about sleep or thoughts?
What about snoring? You know, because that disrupts your sleep too.
You're snoring, or your spouse?
I'm told me.
You're snoring. You enough that you wake yourself up? You may need, have you done a
study?
You haven't. Mm-hmm. You might need it. I mean, if it's that much that it's waking you up, you might need a CPAP, yeah. Or maybe possibly looking at your pillow, because sometimes if your head is in a bad position, okay, it'll throw your neck, that'll increase, right. You know, so you might want to look at your pillow. Mm-hmm. Sleeping on your side is always good as well. Get a body pillow,
right.
Those type of things. Yeah, wow, okay. I thought you were gonna tell me your spouse. You know, the funny thing is, the older I get, I acknowledge why, like in the old days, they had separate rooms. I'm like, yeah. So sleep is the number one thing. And once again, you cannot underestimate it. Okay, the next thing on my list after the sleep, and this whole page right here, chronic stress, this one right here. I urge everyone, I'm not gonna read it, stand up here and read it. But I want you to take time to read this. It's really, really good. Really good. Okay, so go to time your meals. So the next thing that we want to talk about in terms of creating balance and getting rid of symptoms is you need to sleep on a schedule, but you need to eat on a schedule. And this is another thing that I see with women, particularly because we're busy and we're crazy and we're taking care of everyone else, is that we eat erratically. We may eat 10 o'clock in the morning. We may eat by noon. Oh my God, I haven't eaten all day. It may be 11 o'clock at night. Oh my God, I never ate dinner. So just like your body needs to be in a pattern with sleeping, we need to be in a pattern with eating, okay? So when you get up in the morning, you really need to eat within the first hour of getting up, okay? Really, really important. And then, and if anybody's ever done any type of Weight Watchers or any type of diet thing, you know, what do they say? You gotta eat every 3 to 4 hours, every 2 to 3 to 4 hours, because you wanna keep your body in a continual state, your metabolism up here. See, when we don't eat for long periods of time, what happens is, so say in the morning you get up, you haven't eaten all night, your blood sugar's low, right? You eat something, your blood sugar goes up. If we don't eat again, by the time we eat, our blood sugar's dropped all the way down here. And then we eat and our blood sugar goes up and it goes down. Whereas if we're eating small amounts every 2 hours, our blood sugar's never bottoming out. We're always keeping our blood sugar very stable. And you'll find that not only will your symptoms get better, but you may lose weight easier too if you're eating more frequently throughout the day. So the first thing that we want to do is cortisol levels follow our natural circadian rhythm. So do you see that? Everyone see this page right here? It has a little plate. Okay. So the cortisol levels follow our natural rhythm. It begins to rise around 6 in the morning and peaks around 8 a.m. And throughout the day, naturally rises and falls as needed. It tapers off at night and reaches its lowest levels while we are sleeping. Remember we were talking about cortisol? Timing our meals and how much we eat can help regulate our cortisol and its natural cycle. Eating larger meals earlier in the day naturally helps cortisol levels, while eating smaller, lighter meals at the end of the day help maintain hormonal balance. Okay? Exercise also helps to increase cortisol levels. So, when you want to, do you ever hear them say that you should exercise in the morning, that it's always better to exercise? Anyone ever hear that?
Mm-hmm.
One of the reasons, besides the fact that if you get it done early, you got it done, but also it keeps your cortisol levels where it should be. Exercising at night is one of the least good options because you don't want to be dumping that into your system at that time at night.
Keeps you awake?
It can. It can. If it's too close to, you know, if you exercise after work, that might be okay if you're going to bed at like 10 at night. But if you're working out 8 o'clock at night, you need to give your body time to rev down. All right. Let's talk. If you turn to the next page, it says it gives you examples on eating. Try to eat breakfast within an hour of getting up. Enjoy a healthy snack around 9 a.m. Try to eat lunch between 11 and noon. To prevent that large dip. Eat a healthy snack between 2 and 3 to help offset that dip that occurs around 3 and 4. Try to eat dinner between 5 and 6 and eat a light nutritious snack before bed. Okay, so a couple things about breakfast. One of the things about breakfast is you wanna make sure that you're getting protein in the morning. Has anybody heard that?
Mm-hmm.
Really important. Protein shakes, you could do peanut butter on a piece of bread. I don't care what you do. You could do a piece of cheese and some bread, whatever. You need to have the protein with the carbohydrate because remember, carbohydrates break down real quick, whereas protein breaks down slower. So you want something that as you're getting that breaking down of the carbohydrate, the protein's going to break slower and then keep your blood sugar.
Is cereal with milk okay?
It is, but I would want to have a protein with that. Like the cereal, most cereals
are carbs. The milk a protein?
Yeah, but believe it or not, it's not as much protein as you would think.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, but you can sometimes cereals add protein.
Mm-hmm.
We can have a little bit of like yogurt with it, or some, I like peanut butter, it's easy. Have some nuts. A good snack is some almonds and some cranberries. You can have a handful. Okay, choose the right foods and beverages. So let's talk a little bit about that. So everyone knows the difference between a complex carbohydrate and a simple carbohydrate, right? Right? Okay. So we want to move our diet towards more complex carbohydrates. So an example of a complex carbohydrate would be fruits and vegetables, beans, breads, whole grain breads, anything that has a lot of grain, like different types of grains. You want to avoid the white pastas, white breads, white rice, those type of things, okay? Complex carbohydrates break down slower, and they don't spike your blood sugar up as high, okay? Which will also help keep your hormones more balanced. You can read through this on your own. I'm trying to pull out just the important things. Other nutrients important for adrenal health is C, E, and B vitamins. We talked about that. One that I didn't put on the list here that is very important is vitamin D. Does anybody take a vitamin D?
With calcium.
Excellent.
With calcium.
Yes. Did your family doctor do blood work and pull up that you were vitamin D deficient?
Mm-hmm.
Some of us it did? Yes. Mm-hmm. Vitamin D deficiency is really a big problem, and I don't know whether, you know, studies say that's because our quality of food has gone down. Our food is not as healthy as it was 50, 60 years ago. I don't know, but a lot of patients that I see have vitamin D deficiency, so that's great.
I was told because we're wearing so much sunscreen.
We're not getting the sun.
We're not getting the vitamin D from
possibly.
The sun.
Possibly, yeah.
Probably process the hell out of it too.
Right, that's true. So yeah, I'm glad to see that everybody is on a vitamin D.
Now, is there a correlation between A and D? Years ago, they used to make products vitamin A and D
that have it together. You know, it's funny because vitamin A is not water soluble. You'll find that they're very hesitant to have people take vitamin A. Does everyone know the difference between water soluble and non? So you're like C's, E, D, they're all water soluble, and your body will flush out what you don't utilize. But vitamin A is not, and neither is vitamin E. So there are two that the doctor, you know, people are a little more cautious with it. Vitamin A, I think vitamin A does help vitamin D.
That was my
it does help it. Right. It does help you assimilate it. But you'll find they don't always do it together. So. Yeah, they don't make the products together. No. They will do vitamin D with the
calcium
and the magnesium. Sometimes they'll do the three together. Okay. All right, I'm going to save time for questions because I'm running over. Real quick, on your own, there's something in the back. Oops, it's called the gluten effect. Now, I don't want to spend a ton of time on this, but I do want to say that if you're really having symptoms that you have not been able to find any help with, either menopausal symptoms or you're having chronic digestive system issues. I have found a lot of people that have gluten intolerance. They don't have celiac disease, but they have intolerance. And when they pull the gluten out of their diet, they do better and better. And I could probably do a whole class on that, but you can read that on your own, and you can do a little research about it. But the thing is, sometimes we equate a food allergy. Like when you think about a food allergy, you know, people say, oh, they have a peanut allergy, or they have, you know, they can't have shellfish or whatever. But truthfully, we all have things that we do well with and that our body doesn't do well with. And you don't need a scientist to tell you that. Like you could say, you know, every time I eat blah, 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 I don't feel well. And I don't know why, but I have an intolerance to chai. I don't know why. Chai tea. My daughter loves chai tea. Every time, I just don't feel good. If you have a chronic issue that you can't really resolve, I would recommend they have food sensitivity tests. Has anybody had one done? Yeah, it's a blood test, and They send it somewhere to California or Florida, I don't know where they send it. There's different labs that do it, and they actually rate what your body is sensitive to and what it's not sensitive to. So it doesn't mean that you have an allergy like you eat the strawberry, you're gonna get hives. It means that your body, for whatever reason, just doesn't process it properly. And the more that you pull that out, I have the craziest story. I had a patient who had burning in her feet. And I mean, we had been through, it was not her back, it was not diabetic neuropathy, it was nothing. We could not figure out what it was. Her family doctor, myself, I mean, we had her in a million different places. Finally I said, let's just do a food sensitivity. And here it was like crazy. She was sensitive to, it was oat and barley or something really, I can't remember now because this was a few years ago, but pulled it out of her diet and that was it. I mean, it was something really bizarre like that. So if you have something that's chronic, that you've tried different things, I really recommend doing a food sensitivity test. So you can read through that, and that's for a whole other class. But it's all about gluten and just how our bodies are not able to sometimes process it as well. So, I want to save time for questions. Anybody have any particular questions? Yeah.
I ended menopause like 6 years ago. All of a sudden, lately, I've been having night sweats. For the past 2 weeks, like every two or three nights or two nights in a row, I have heavy night sweats till my sheets are popping. How come this came back?
How could that get? So, it could be some, like, once again, it could be an imbalance. So, I would check and see, what have you done different the last maybe month or two? Have you been having more caffeine? Have you been drinking alcohol? Did you start a new supplement? Are you on a different medication? Like, you want to look at, like, is there something that kind of created an imbalance? 6 years is a long time to have to go through it and then have it re.
Is there anything you can do to reduce night sweats?
There's some, and I have them in here. One thing with night sweats that works well, one is vitamin E.
Mm-hmm.
And the other one is the black cohosh. Mm-hmm. Has anybody had success with the black cohosh?
Yes,
black cohosh. So you can Google it and look at, you know, what recommended, what the dosage should be. But for the vitamin E, it's usually like 400 to 800.
But the use of vitamin E is not water soluble.
I'm telling you what to take. 400 to 800. You wouldn't take more than that.
Okay.
But black cohosh, you can write that down.
All right.
And let me see if I put a list of other.
Is that a cream?
Black cohosh. It comes in a cream or it can come in a pill too. They make it different ways. Yeah, black cohosh, I did not put that down there. Okay. Licorice root as well is another one. All right. But I'm thinking there's some kind of imbalance. There's something different going on. Like it could be.
Could even be cleaning my shower curtain too, like they said, plastics and things like that. Could we get in too close to a plastic?
It could be, but it would be more something that you haven't been doing that you just started or something, because I'm sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's got to be something, probably something that just kind of pushed things back out of an imbalance. But black cohosh is definitely, and licorice root are the two, and vitamin E.
I got one more question.
Yeah.
While you're on me. If you cannot take white flour, caffeine, and sugar out of your diet, because I'm addicted.
Yeah.
Can you do things to counterbalance that for your liver?
I mean, one is drinking a lot of water to flush out the toxins, you know, we took an apple a day, but I mean, you don't have to be 100%. Like, you just want to cut it down. So how much coffee do you drink?
A lot, like three big glass iced coffee a day.
That's a lot.
Yeah,
that's a lot. So, you know, maybe we could start with trying to do decaf.
I just wondered if
something. You know, the thing, there are different things you can take for the liver, different supplements. But I mean, I like first to kind of clean stuff instead of like putting more stuff in. I kind of like to take out.
Yeah.
So it'd be nice to see, even if you cut back 10%. You know.
Right.
So anyone have any questions or easy question
about the water where it says 8 to 10 glasses of pure water daily? Does that mean?
not
right, so,
the lemon slices.
No, I love lemon. Lemon is great. Lemon,
lime,
orange,
yeah.
lime, anything that's not, you know, anything
yeah,
like that is perfect.
Sometimes I just get tired of regular
yeah.
water.
Or seltzer water is good
lime,
too.
Seltzer.
Not as good as regular water. But yeah, you can put all sorts of fruit in it. You don't want to put anything. I hate those like Propel waters. They got junk in them. I'm like, come on. Anything to make money. You know, you're even ruining water. But yeah, water, that's great. That's great.
What about like distilled water? Or my dad swears by that.
You know, I tell people you don't have to do distilled water. You don't have to do distilled water. If you're going to put money into it, I would like to see people do an RO system, a reverse osmosis. Just pulls out all the crap.
That's what mine is.
It is. It's really good.
Yes, that.
Yeah, and it's not that expensive. You can basement one's a good one because that does the whole house. But you can put it right under your sink. You can get them at, you know.
Where about softened water?
Softened water is not necessarily a health issue. That's more, I mean, it is, but that's more for, the thing about the softened water is that if your water's hard, it's going to leach your pipes, which puts crap in your water. Mm-hmm. So it's not, a hard water or salt water on your body is not really that big of a difference. It's more the stuff that it brings in when it's hard. So you soft water is better.
But isn't the minerals good for you in the hard water?
I don't know. I live in an old home, and we had such hard water when we had our water tested. It had a lot of crap. It shouldn't. It was way too high. So, and I would also recommend everybody get their water tested. You know, even if you do it every other year, like Suburban Water, or you know, spend the $100 to have them come in and test your water, your tap water, to see how it is.
Even if you have a filter.
You have a filter. You have an RO system.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe every 5 years, just to make sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay.
What about when you go through the change, you start getting like depression, not depression, but you know, what supplement is good to more
St. John's wort is fantastic.
Okay.
Also, sleep. 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 I am such a big proponent of sleeping, good water, and good food. Like, those three things, you know, it's funny too, because everybody in this day and age, they want me to give them something. Give me, tell me what vitamin, I'm like, stop. So, what I want, but St. John's wort. Definitely worth. Yeah. I'd like everybody to pick three things, like from what we talked about tonight. Write it down, three things that you can do immediately. That's like, right now you're thinking, you know what? I'm gonna get to bed by 10. Or, you know what, right now I'm going to cut down my coffee a lot, like, meh. Or, you know what, and I'm going to look at my diet and I'm going to make sure that I'm spending the time on Sunday night to plan my meals for the week so that I can take stuff to work, or I can make my little packets to bring with me so that, you know, I'm so many hours in, I can throw a couple almonds in my mouth and keep my blood sugar up. Okay, everybody write down three things. You don't have to tell me, you don't have to share them. But I want you to like walk out of here going, that's what I'm gonna do. So there's a ton of information in here, a ton. You know what, when you get home and you're reading it, this is our office number. I'm in on Mondays and Tuesdays. I work Monday, Tuesday, Saturdays, but you can leave a message for me and I will call you back. If you read this, I'll give you my email. My email is mcckam@comcast.net. So if you read it and you're like, you know, I was wondering, shoot me an email. It's easy for me to just shoot you an email right back. And then, like I said, for those that came in late, I had said that this blue sheet, part of our office, we really believe in education. The more that you know about your health, the better decisions that you will make. So we do Monday nights. We do workshops every Monday night at 6:30. They last about half hour, 45 minutes. There's no charge to come. You don't have to be a patient to come. We do all sorts of cool topics. You just call the office, just let them know that you want to come. They'll let you know, make sure there's enough room for guests.
When is the safety pin cycle?
Oh, you gotta come find out.
No, actually,
safety pin cycle, it's cool. It's basically talks about how our brains tell our bodies everything that it should do, and that it's just a big feedback loop. And actually, hormones are a big feedback. I mean, even your endocrine system, you know, I eat something, I eat sugar, what's going to happen? My blood sugar goes up, and then my pancreas says, oh, my sugar's up, it dumps in the insulin. Mm-hmm. So it's just about, it's about rhythm and cycles in our life and in our bodies. And then I put a business card, and I also put, this is called a gift of health card. If you, I don't know anybody who sees chiropractor already, I think everybody should get checked. But if you don't have a chiropractor, if you do have one, yay, I think that's awesome. If you don't, this is a gift of health card. You can come into our office and get checked for $25, and that would cover your first appointment just to see, you know, just to do a full exam. Okay, yes?
Do you do AK work or nutrition response testing or anything?
We don't, but I can refer you to someone that does. Yeah, I can give you the name. You know what, email me.
Okay.
And just remind me that you saw me here. I actually have a friend who's in Pottstown, and she works with Standard Process and does AK and nutritional response.
Okay.
Which is actually great products.
Yeah,
we sell them, but I don't do the nutrition. I mean, I'll do it if someone...
Do you sell them?
I do sell Standard Process. You can get the Standard Process through me, but I don't do the whole protocol. Like,
right.
If I have a patient, I mean, we do the type of...
What are we talking about?
Yeah. Okay, we've got our own conversation here.
Too many letters.
Nutritional response is where you do different muscle testing to see if the body has certain deficiencies. And that is one type of for people that do vitamins, that's one way that they tell if you need that particular,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Right.
And there's one company called Standard Process. We sell the products. I will do nutritional response, but that's not my primary way that I practice.
Okay.
I do more like family care. My associate, she does mostly children and babies, and I do women. I mean, I do more family care, and my husband does sports. So we have more of a general type practice. But email me, I can give you her name and number. She's excellent.
And what are the products? Are they supplements?
They're supplements. They're whole food supplements.
Mm-hmm.
So they're different than what you would buy like at, you know, at the store, because it doesn't have any, it's all made from food products.
And they're specific to that, like if you were having an adrenal issue, you would get some Drenamin or some
right.
Adrenotropin or something like that. Whatever your body needs, then.
Now, if you have a doctor that you've done it and you know what you need, I can even give you the link and you can order directly through the company.
Do they let you do that now?
I think they do.
It used to be only a healthcare provider.
Yeah.
With Standard Process?
Yeah.
I know my husband used to be able to order them for us.
Yeah.
But we were getting them from a chiropractor for a while.
I'll find out for you. I've given people the website, and I tell them just to, you know, if it's something they need ongoing.
Well, they may have changed it.
They may have changed it. But it is good to see someone if you need to be retested to see what you need. But it is good. It's really a good product. Really, really, really good product, Standard Process. Okay, does anyone have any other questions? Oh, one more. No more coffee. No.
I eat a big dinner and then go to bed at 10 o'clock. I wake up at 5 and eat breakfast and go back to sleep until 6:37. I like to sleep after I eat.
That's a crazy
you?
Schedule. I
yeah.
don't know. That's nutty.
Just eating right after you sleeping right after you eat, is that really bad?
You know, it's not really bad, but it's really weird for the whole site. That's my not doctor answer. I don't think it's bad, but it's weird because it really doesn't follow the normal.
Babies go to sleep right after they
babies
eat.
Are growing. They're
growing.
Oh, you're
still nursing.
Are you feeling tired? Is that what is?
I feel comfy after I eat and I want to sleep.
You want to go back to sleep
yeah.
for a little bit?
Yeah.
Huh? I can't think of anything.
Okay.
That, I mean, it kind of throws off that whole pattern. I don't like a big meal, though, before you go to bed.
Right.
And I'll tell you why. I'm running over. I'm sorry. When you eat a lot before you go to bed at night, your body is not spent on healing. It's spent on digestion.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And
okay.
The study of sleep is so amazing. So, I mean, if you really have trouble sleeping, I would recommend doing a sleep study. It's amazing. Like, you should spend so much time in all these different phases of sleep, and I won't go through all of them. But if you're not getting the right amount of time in these different phases, your body's not going through the proper cycles that it should. It's really fascinating.
I also found that if I ate a big meal, I was definitely going to wake up at 2 or 3 in the morning because my blood sugar had dropped so much after eating, you know, the big meals. So.
It's really not good. What I say to people is, before you go to bed, a little bit of like yogurt, or have like a banana and a little bit of peanut butter, or have a few nuts, something real light that'll just kind of, you'll sleep better. Yeah. So, well, thank you for having
me.
Thank you.